That is not a Photoshop, that's from Tantalus, and what a great view on that particular day. I can't say enough about how proud I am of the Hope Youth Corps participants and just your hearts of inspiration. I love the sharing today. Tremendous, tremendous sharing. It just shows the power of God and how God cares for each one of us. And I think about what God is doing at our Hope Youth Corps with the teen camp that happened a few weeks ago. I know some of the families have their youth at the LA youth camp that just finished yesterday. God is doing tremendous things in our families. And I'm so thankful for the spiritual momentum, the spiritual inspiration that God is pouring into our families. Let's not take it for granted, brothers and sisters, but let's be grateful for what the Lord continues to do. Amen. Let's transition a little bit here. As we have been reading from the book of James, I want you to go ahead and turn your Bibles over to the book of James. We've been talking about a lesson series called All Grown Up, the study of the book of James. And as we read and study the book of James, we will see, and I want you to remember that the purpose of this whole book is to help us grow up, help us to mature, help us to be complete. And maturity is not dependent on age. Let me just say that the young adults that came up here and shared today, there was some maturity displayed. We see some, they may be young age-wise, but there is great wisdom that's coming from their hearts. They see things through perspective. And so you may be a teen, but you can be wise in the Lord. You may be mature. Maturity is not dependent on age. You can have a very old person display a lot of immaturity. And conversely, you can have a very young person display lots of maturity. It all has to do with how you and I respond to different trials and testings in our life. Last time we talked about persevering through trials. I really appreciate Alessandra's testimony. It really moved my heart. How she'd gone through so many different trials, and yet she went back to the Lord. She got her strength and her foundation from the Lord. And all of us will experience trials and testings in our life. It's not a matter of if, but when. And how often the trials will happen in our life. James talks about ask for wisdom from God. Live life with perspective. Gain wisdom about the poor and the wealthy. Gain wisdom. And that's the sign of maturity. We want to grow up in the Lord. We're going to have to persevere through trials. We are not God's sheltered people, as the book of James talks about. We are God's scattered people. That means we're going to have testings in our life. God is going to allow different trials to enter into our life for the whole purpose of making us stronger. You got to get in the gym and lift some weights if your muscles are going to get stronger. If you're sitting at home, sitting on the couch and watching TV all day, guess what? You're not going to be fit for a marathon. It's not going to work. If you want to get stronger, you're going to have some resistance in your life. And God allows different spiritual events to build us up, to help us to get stronger for the Lord. I want us to show a movie clip here, a couple minutes here. It's from the movie Courageous. It's about four different men, but this particular gentleman named Javier, he was applying for a higher position at his current workplace. And however, in an earlier interview with his boss actually asked him to fudge on some of the accounting numbers so that the company could look much better. And so now, coming back for a follow-up interview, Javier gives the boss his answer what he plans to do. Let's go ahead and take a look at this clip.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Mr. Martinez. How are you this morning?
Fine, thank you. How are you?
I want to know you. Please, have a seat. I trust you've had time to think about our conversation yesterday.
Yes, I did.
Well, what did you decide? Are you on my team?
Mr. Tyson, I am very grateful to have a job here. I cannot do as you have asked.
And why is that?
Because it is wrong, sir. It would be dishonoring to my God and my family to lie on that report.
Do you understand what this may do to your job here?
Yes, sir, I do.
Javier, may I shake your hand? Young man, you just gave me the right answer. I've been looking for someone to manage inventory and shipping, and quite frankly, you were the last person on my list. But I need somebody I can trust. Will you take the job? We'll adjust your pay.
I'd be honored to, sir.
Good. Then the job is yours. Now, Walter will go over all the specifics with you, and I'll make the announcement to the staff on Monday. Congratulations, Javier. Oh, and I'm here. Thanks for your integrity. It's rare.
Well done, Javier. After six times, I was getting discouraged.
Job interview this week, you be Javier. What a great clip that depicts being tested, going through some testing. And Javier passed the test. And you know, perhaps God puts us through these types of events and incidences in our lives to test what's really going on inside. Test what's going on in our heart. Test what's going on in our minds. Perhaps God allows different circumstances to go into your life so that your heart will be revealed. You can see. You can be tested. You can be put up with the decision to choose right or wrong in your life. We're going to continue in the book of James. The title of the lesson is How to Handle Temptations. How to Handle Temptations. The book of James seamlessly goes into talking about this area. But have you ever been tempted to sin when you go through a difficult time? A challenging time, a trial that's in your life. You know, maybe you're going through some financial hardship right now as an individual or as a person. And you're tempted. You're tempted to be faithless. You're tempted to be worried. You're going through some testing right now. Or maybe you're having a difficult time with a person or a relationship or with an individual that the relationship is not going well. You're getting angry. You're getting impatient. You are tempted to sin. You're tempted to go and choose a direction that's going to be harmful for you and going to be harmful for other people. Or maybe you've got problems in your marriage. People may or may not know about it, but you've got problems, deep problems in your marriage. You're giving up. You don't have any hope. You're not hopeful that it's going to work. You're getting frustrated. Or maybe you're going through an illness, a challenge, a sickness, a disability, and you're blaming God or you're questioning God about His love and why is this happening to you. Or you're battling with some sin that's just hard to overcome. You're wrestling with it. You're coming to church week after week, and you know you don't sense like you're changing. You don't sense that you're overcoming a particular sin in your life, or you're trying to escape your life, escape the world, or escape or deal with the stress in your life, and you're getting discouraged. You're feeling overwhelmed. You want to give up. You know, be mindful. Back in the first century, the book of James was written. These disciples were being persecuted for their faith. It was life or death. It was life or death. And certainly many of us aren't facing those kinds of challenges today. But we feel the pressures. We feel the battle that's going on in our lives. We know there's a spiritual war that's taking place. And it's real. God knew that we would be tempted. And this is what the book of James addresses next. Let's read verse 13 through 18. When tempted, no one should say, God's tempting me, for God cannot be tempted. by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. Then, after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it's full grown, gives birth to death. Don't be deceived, my dear brothers and sisters. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created. If we're going to be successful in handling different temptations and trials in our lives, then we need to consider a couple things that the book of James helps to point out. The first thing is you've got to consider the process. Consider the process of what the Bible explains here. The Bible talks about when we're tempted, here's the thing, don't blame God. When you're tempted, don't blame God. Don't make excuses. Don't blame others. Don't blame God specifically. Because the Bible says that God is not the one who is tempting us. He doesn't do the tempting. It's outside his nature. It's outside his very spirit, as the Bible talks about here. One, God cannot be tempted with evil, as 1 Corinthians, or James chapter 1, verse 13 says. He is holy. He is righteous. He is pure. God's holiness doesn't allow himself to be tempted by any kind of evil. He will withstand any kind of evil that comes his way. There's no way that God can be infiltrated by any kind of evilness whatsoever.
Right.
He is pure. He is holy. He is lovely. He is perfect. He is sinless. Amen. It is against God's nature for him to even be tempted by evil. Can you imagine that? And then secondly, it talks about how God can not only be tempted by evil, he doesn't tempt anyone. He doesn't tempt you or me.
That's right.
When you're tempted, we have to understand God is not the one tempting us. It doesn't come from him. He doesn't set us up for failures. He doesn't set us up so we can fall and never get back up.
That's right.
God loves us. He cares for us. He wants you and me to be able to be saved, to go to heaven one day, and to be like Christ. This scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13 says, "No temptation has seized you except what is common to man, and God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so you can stand up under it." Do you realize that with any temptation you face, there is a way out? Any kind of trial or any kind of testing that happens in our lives, there is a way out. You've just got to be patient enough and prayerful enough to see it. And it could be as simple as praying. It could be as simple as walking away from the temptation.
Right.
It could be as simple as changing your thoughts, getting those thoughts out of your mind, chasing those negative thoughts away from you. It's amazing how powerful our mind is and how the battle starts within our minds. It starts with our thoughts, and whatever we just allow the gateway of our mind to allow in, negative thoughts, down thoughts, faithless thoughts, if you bathe yourself in those types of thoughts, then guess what? You're going to become like that. You've got to be more aggressive and more on guard to what you allow your thinking to be involved in. It's easy to stop looking. Just stop looking. Right. Stop, you know, the teen said lingering. Stop lingering. But did you know there's always a way out? God always provides a way out for you and me.
Amen.
Where does temptation come from? Well, the Bible describes that it comes from a few different areas. James describes it as it's a process. There are steps that take place before sin actually takes root. Step one here, verse 14, it talks about that each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire. That's step one, is desire. Desire is step one. Every one of us, there are no exceptions. We are tempted and we are drawn away by our own evil desires. This word desire simply means a longing, especially for things that are forbidden or harmful. There is in us a sinful nature that has desires for evil.
Right.
We want to be the bad guy in the movies at times. You know, we want to go after the fruit that's presented from the garden. Now, it could mean lust also, but it doesn't necessarily have to do with sexual sins, but absolutely it can include sexual sins as well. And the normal desires that we have are from God. God has given us desires. And in and of themselves, they're not sinful. Without desires that God gives us, then we couldn't function. Unless we felt hunger or thirst, we wouldn't eat or drink. Then we would die. We would not live. Without fatigue, the body is not going to rest, and we would eventually wear out. Even sex is a normal desire. Without it, there would be no multiplication. There would be no mankind without sex. But here's the thing. It's when we want to fulfill these desires outside of the will of God. That's the key. It's when we have these desires and we want to fulfill them and satisfy them outside the will of God. That's when we get in trouble. That's when we are playing the fence. That's when we're looking for trouble. Eating is normal, but gluttony is sin. Sleeping is normal, but laziness is sin. Hebrews 13:4 says, marriage should be honored by all, and the marriage bed kept pure. But God will judge the adulterer and all the sexually immoral. Here is the secret. If we want success in temptation, then the secret is constant control of our desires. You've got to be in control of your urges, of your cravings, of your desires in your life. It's up to you. It's up to you to be in control of those things. That's the sinful nature that is living in you. And these desires must be your servants, not your slaves, not your masters. They've got to be your slaves and not your masters. If you allow your desires to master you, then absolutely you're gonna be easily knocked off. You're going to easily be given into temptation and sin. You're going to find yourselves trapped and hooked into a pattern of your life because you are not controlling the desire that is in you. Temptation comes from our own desires, our sinful nature. You know, we see something, we want it, and we know we shouldn't get it. We want something, but we know we shouldn't have it. It's a desire, it's a craving. Sometimes these cravings are so strong, it just takes over. It takes over. The desire may be from things such as just having your own way. You're selfish. You just want things your own way. Everything's about you. It's focused on you. You want it your way. You want to accomplish things. You want to do your own thing. You want comfort. When things don't go your way, you're easily angered. You're impatient. It's focused on self. Food. The love of food. You just love food. You want more of it. You can't control yourself. You can't put those Hershey Kisses down. You keep going after things. Food is like medicine. Maybe the desire comes from you want to have sex. You can't stop this desire. Your hormones are on fire, and it's there. But you want immoral sex. Maybe you want greater position or advancement in your job. Maybe there's pride, there's power, there's control that you want. Recognition or authority. Alcohol, drugs. You crave for these things. Cigarettes, pornography, clothes, possessions. Technology, video games, whatever it may be. You're not in control. You're being mastered by your desires. They are not slaves in your life, but they are masters. And they are controlling you. And you wonder why it's hard to do the will of God. It's because you are trying to satisfy your desires outside of God's will.
Come on.
The secret is constant control. Constant control. Don't blame other people for how you act. The devil made me do it. No, he didn't make you do it. Sometimes you do it. Don't blame your spouse. Don't blame your kids. Don't blame your boss. Don't blame, you know, your coworker. Don't blame your neighbor. Don't blame the car mechanic. No, we have control of how we're going to respond through trials. You have full control of how your desires will respond. And there are times I want to just, last night, our printer wasn't working. I told Sarah, I just wanted to curse. I just wanted to throw something. Not her, but something. I just don't like it when things aren't efficient. Simple printer. Black ink. Because it just bothers me. Why am I even sharing that? Have you ever wanted to curse? You ever wanted to get angry? Throw things? Epson printer? Rip it out of the wall? Hot, humid, no trade winds? Air conditioning? Upstairs? You get the picture. Are these desires your master or your servant? If you're going to be mature, you're going to have to be aggressive and on guard with your desires. You cannot let them master you. The second step that James talks about is deception. This is when our minds are engaged, okay? This is when we start wrestling with our thoughts. This is when we're deciding whether we're going to go for this temptation or not. This is when we're intellectualizing whether, okay, what are the consequences here? Am I going to be caught? Am I going to be okay? Is this all right? This is when our minds are being engaged. No temptation appears as temptation. It always seems more attractive than it really is. More alluring than it really is. And James uses two different phrases here that he talks about in verse 14. He talks about being drawn away, dragged away. That carries the idea of baiting a trap like a hunter. When a hunter, if you watch Animal Planet, Animal Channel, you will see hunters and they will bait a trap. They will hide the trap, put some bait. You see Jurassic Park. You see that little goat being sacrificed to the T-Rex. Bah! It gets thrown in there. Remember that? That's bait. That's a bait. T-Rex, you know, he smells this thing. He's coming through the bush and wham, gone. All that's left is a chain. That's what it talks about when you get dragged away. It's like baiting a trap. And then James uses the word enticed. It's like baiting a hook. Fishermen, when they are baiting a hook, rarely will you have a fish bait or a bite, an empty hook. If you have that, you've got some pretty dumb fish coming around here. No. The fish will bite a hook when there's bait on the hook. This is what the devil does. He gives us bait. He gives us bait, and hidden behind it is a trap, hidden behind it is a hook. We don't realize it. Temptation is so attractive, it draws us away. The bait is so enticing that we bite at it. The bait is so alluring that we're intrigued. We want to taste it. What's the bait that Satan uses today? He'll use a lot of different forms of bait. He'll use the internet as a mechanism for the bait. He'll use a picture. He'll use an image to get you thinking. He'll use an email. Son and I, we shared our email, and we get like weird emails sometimes. We just get weird emails of some sketchy things. Of like, you know, my name is so-and-so, and I'm from this country, and I'm stranded and I need some money, or we get emails of hey, you know, looking for a husband, looking for a wife, that kind of thing, and go, what is this? That's bait. It's bait for you to click. It's bait for you to look. It's bait for you to go down that tunnel. Satan will use that. He'll use a positive or negative conversation you have with people. If you have a negative conversation, it gets you to go in places that Satan wants you to go. You'll start thinking of evil things to do to a person you're not in agreement with. Our minds are a terrible place sometimes. Satan will use a compliment. Maybe you're getting complimented by a coworker. He's paying attention to you, she's paying attention to you, and you feel a little drawn, but you know you're married. Or you know that person's married. And you go, not good. Satan will use a suspicion, a curiosity, an attractive person, a tragic event, vulnerable emotions and feelings. There are lots of different types of baits that Satan will use to get you to go into the trap, to get you to bite that hook. It may look alluring, but you don't realize the pain and the suffering that it could cost. Ask anyone who has broken the law, or stolen something, or committed adultery, or been addicted to gambling or drugs. Ask anyone who has gone down that path, and they've reached sobriety in their lives, they realize they shouldn't have done it. They shouldn't have done it. And that's the problem. The deception is the bait looks exciting. That's the deception. Satan puts out bait for us that tempts us, that allures us, that wants us to get hooked and trapped and not realizing there is pain and sorrow. Lot would have never moved towards Sodom and Gomorrah had he not seen the well-watered plains of Jordan. Lot looked and he saw that this land was better. He went with his eyes. He went with what he saw, and that trapped him. That dragged him away. When King David looked at his neighbor's wife, Bathsheba, he would have never committed adultery if he understood the consequences of what would happen. Killing of Uriah, the death of his son, the abuse of his daughter. King David would have never done what he did if he understood clearly the consequences of his decisions. When Jesus was tempted by Satan, he was dealt with the temptation time and time again. But you know what Jesus did? Jesus always went back, as it says, it is written. Jesus always went back to Scripture. That's what kept him safe. He always had Scripture on our heart. You know what? You and I would do much better in our lives handling temptation if we just had Scripture more on our heart. If you had more Scriptures memorized in your mind, in your heart, if you put more effort and pushed yourself, when you were tempted, you would go back to Scripture. You would recall different passages that God has taught you, and those would keep you strong. You would take every thought and make it captive and obedient to Jesus Christ. That's how we handle temptation. When the bait is there, don't just look at the bait. Understand the consequences that may take place. Step three in the process is death. We move from the emotions and desires to from the intellect, the deception, to the will. What I mean by the will, this is your willingness. This is when you are willing and you give your consent to do this. This is when you decide, after you've thought about it, you've been tempted, the desire's there, and you've thought about it, and you go, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. You're crossing the line. I'm going to swear. I'm going to be impure. I'm going to lie. I'm going to steal. I'm going to falsify some things. It's your will. That's when you decide to act on the temptation. James pictures it as desire being fertilized, which leads to conception, which leads to the birthing of sin in verse 15, which leads to death. Whether you feel it or not, when you're at this point, you're trapped, you're hooked. Now here's the thing. Unless you take steps to repent, this sin will mature in your life. Unless you take steps to change, the sin will mature. When it's full grown, the Bible talks about, it's going to result in death. But here's the hopeful thing. You can get out of it. You can get out of this process. You can get out of this assembly line that Satan has going with our desires and the deceit that's going on. You can actually get out of it by deciding, by controlling, by confessing, by talking, by turning, by stopping, by doing things that are going to help you flee from the temptation. You can get out of this conveyor belt. Christian living is a matter of the will. Making decisions according to your will, not the feelings. This is a big key, brothers and sisters. This is a big key. It's not unusual to hear people say, well, I don't feel like reading my Bible, or I don't feel like praying, or I don't like joining an Ohana group, or I don't feel like sharing my faith, or come to church, or I don't feel like I love my spouse anymore. Here's the thing. Children operate based on their feelings.
Right.
Mature people, adults, operate by their will.
Right.
Whether they feel like it or not, they know it's right. And so they operate that way. They make decisions not based on their feelings, but on its righteousness. And this explains why immature Christians fall into sin all the time, over and over and over again. Has nothing to do with physical age. It has everything to do with how well are you connected with God. How well are you righteous with the Lord? How well are you connected to the Lord? And this is why immature Christians easily fall into different temptations.
Right.
They let their feelings make the decisions more than their will. And if you want to be used by God more, then you're going to have to exercise your will of what is right a whole lot more than listening to your feelings. Because if you're living your Christian life based on your feelings, then you are a man or woman who is up and down. You have good weeks, bad weeks, and everything between. And you're bobbing in the ocean like a cork without being anchored to any kind of solid rock. God wants us to be anchored in Him. Philippians 2, verse 12 through 13 says, Paul says, therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act according to His good purpose. Whenever we are faced with temptations, get your eyes off the bait and look ahead to see the consequences, for the wages of sin is death. If temptation hits you, when it hits you, then get your eyes off the bait. Change your thoughts. Refer to Scripture. Rely on the Word of God to help you through the testing and the trial. If temptation comes you through your senses, seeing, hearing, touching, tasting, then sometimes you just need to physically get out of there. Physically turn, physically move, physically walk out. Physically do something different. So number one, if we're going to handle temptation well, you need to consider the process. There is a process. Sin just doesn't automatically happen in your life or mine. There are steps that take place. Be hopeful of the fact that you can get out of these steps. If you grab it early enough, then a multitude of sins can be covered over. You don't have to give in to temptation. There is a way out. The last thing that we've got to consider, if we want to handle temptation well, is lastly, consider God's goodness. Consider God's goodness. One of the enemy's tricks is to convince us that God doesn't love us. He's holding out on us. He doesn't really care for us. And that's what Satan did to Eve in the garden. He suggested that if God really loved her, He would permit her to eat from the forbidden tree. Some people think it's an apple. It's not an apple. People say it's an apple. It's some kind of fruit. I think it was mango, but I don't. Just to clarify, it doesn't say it was an apple. When Satan tempted Jesus, he raised the question of hunger. And Jesus was in the desert. If your Father loves you, why are you hungry? And this is what will happen when we go through trials or testings. One of the first things we do is we question God.
Right.
Why, God, are you allowing this to happen? Get me out of it. You put me in this, get me out of it.
Right.
And we question God's love. We question God's care for us. We question those types of things. What the book of James teaches us about God and who He is, about His goodness. The first thing is God gives only good gifts. Every good and perfect gift is from above. If it came from God, it is good. If it doesn't come from God, it is not good. Even if we don't see the goodness immediately, we've got to have a conviction. God is good. He gives perfect gifts. He will never give us bad gifts for our harm, for our failure. I think another thing we see is that God gives constantly. The Bible talks about that these gifts coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights. God just keeps giving. It's constant. Even if we don't see His gifts, He keeps sending gifts into our life. Another thing we see is that God doesn't change. He doesn't change like the shifting shadows. He is unchanging. This means that you and I should never question God's love or doubt His goodness in our lives. God is never changing. He's not like us. He doesn't hold grudges. He doesn't complain. He doesn't hold things against us. It's amazing how He forgets our sin. As far as the east is from the west, He remembers it no more. This is unbelievable how He can erase these things through the blood of Jesus. But God does not change. You know, if King David had remembered the goodness of the Lord, he would not have taken Bathsheba and committed adultery with her. At least that's what the prophet Nathan told him when he confronted David. In 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 7 and 8, Nathan said to David, "You are the man. This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. I anointed you king over Israel. I delivered you from the hand of Saul. I gave your master's house to you, your master's wives into your arms. I gave you the house of Israel and Judah. And if all this had been too little, I would have given you even more." I want you to notice how many times God says, "I've given you this, I gave you that, I've given you this. And you know what? I would have given you more. I would have blessed you even more if you hadn't done this, David. You blew it. And I'm going to have to discipline you, because that's who I am. But I would have given you more. And I'll forgive you, David. But unfortunately, your earthly life isn't going to be the same. You're going to have consequences in your life because of what you've done. Not just to me, but to other people." Now, conversely, when you look at Joseph's life, it was the positive attitude of remembering God's goodness in his life that totally prevented him from going down this road of temptation. In Genesis chapter 39, Joseph says, but he refused. "With me in charge," he told her, "my master does not concern himself with anything in the house. Everything he owns, he has entrusted to my care. No one is greater in this house than I am. My master has withheld nothing from me except you, because you are his wife. How then could I do such a wicked thing and sin against God?" Joseph understood where all the blessings came from God. He remembered God's goodness in his life, and that goodness prevented him from sinning. You know, if you want to handle temptation a lot better in your life, you've got to remember God's goodness. You've got to remember how good God has been for you. You need to start counting your blessings. And start just laying them out of how blessed your life really is. And just start taking inventory of how much He's blessed your life and saving you, first of all, as a Christian. If He's given you a spouse, then thank God that you've got a spouse to be a partner in the Lord here in your earthly life. If God has blessed you with children, then don't exasperate them. Love them. Build them up. Strengthen them. Point them to the Lord. If you've got a job, amen. If you need to find a job, amen. Be a Javier next time in that next interview. We would do a lot better if we just started to count our blessings. Amen. And how fortunate we are. The next time you're tempted, start thinking about God's goodness in your life. Don't toy with the devil's bait. The Bible talks about in verse 18, He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be kind, the kind of first fruits of all He created. If God's goodness doesn't get you to prevent from being sinful, then think about what God has done within you if you're a born-again Christian. If you're born again, think about what He's done in your life, inside of you. Not on the outside, but think about what He's done on the inside to change who you are. And that's why studying the Bible, becoming a Christian, getting baptized, repenting of sin, that is all necessary to get on that path, to get off that conveyor belt of the process of sin and going down that path. But consider what God has done in your life. Just look within to the quality that God has given you. And this is not of a physical birth. This is a spiritual birth that God has allowed so many of us to seize. This is the work of God. It's not the work of man. This is through the Bible, through His scriptures, directing us and generating this new birth. We didn't earn it. We didn't deserve it. God has given it to us by His grace. And of all the creatures that God has made, Christians are the highest of value. We are the highest in God's eyes. We share God's nature of being born again in Him. And it is beneath a Christian's dignity to stoop to the level of Satan, to accept the bait for desires of the sinful things. A higher birth means a higher life for you and me, brothers and sisters. A higher birth of being born again means there are greater expectations for your life and my life, and it's because it's of God. And God equips us. This is something that the world does not have. They don't know of these things. They don't know of this type of equipment and being ways to be prepared to fight off the challenges in their life. It's the experience of this new birth. If we let our old nature rule, then we're going to live like the flesh. We inherited our sinful nature from Adam, and the Bible talks about how he failed. But being born again, we have a new nature. A new nature from the Spirit of God. And God's Spirit will always succeed. There was a Sunday school child that explained the matter in simple terms. He said, two men live in my heart. The old Adam and Jesus. When temptation knocks at the door, somebody has to answer it. If I let Adam answer it, I will sin. So I send Jesus to answer it. He always wins. Today, what sins do you need to repent of? What sins has God shown you that you've got to get a whole lot serious, a whole lot more serious about? What desires in your life need to be put in its right position of being a slave, not masters? Well, what decisions will you make when it comes to being tempted in your life? What good things from God do you need to consider? A whole lot more. If you're going to handle temptation a lot more successfully. Next time you face temptation, brothers and sisters, consider the process. There are steps. You and I don't have to sin. We can get out of it. We can make choices like Javier did in that interview. We can make choices, and we don't have to give in to temptation. You can choose the right way. Secondly, consider God's goodness. All that He has done for you. If you do these things, then you and I are going to be on the road to maturity. You and I will live with a totally different perspective. We will be better equipped to handle all the flaming arrows that Satan throws into our lives. Let's glorify God. Let's make great decisions as Christian men and women. Let's be a light to the people here in Hawaii. Let's lift the Lord up with our lives and our decisions. Thank you very much.